So does it work? Okay.
Test. Ora, muito bem. Boa tarde a todos. Vamos dar início a mais um seminário deste ciclo de seminários da Mestrado em Informática Médica. Hoje cabe-me a mim fazer as honras do seminário. Por uma questão de cortesia, vou passar para inglês, naturalmente. Thank you all for being here. We'll start our seminar that is included in this series of seminars in medical informatics, organized by the Medical Informatics master course here at the University of Porto. Today we'll have the pleasure to have Professor Peter Lucas with us. He's a researcher at the Radboud University in the Netherlands. He's also a professor at the Leiden University. He's very well known for several works on machine learning applied to medical cases and to clinical medicine. In fact, his first degree was a medical doctor, and then he decided, well, why not take this into another direction and have a PhD in computer science. And he's very well known for probabilistic graphical models and other methods that he probably will talk about this today. So it's my pleasure to have him here. I thank you very much for being here, and I hope you all enjoy this seminar. So thank you, Peter.
Thank you for inviting me. So what I want to focus you today is on a rather recent problem. That's the problem of trying to understand the interaction between different diseases. And for that particular sort of problems, you need a lot of data. So that explains the title of my talk, which focuses on interaction between diseases and rather hypey sort of subject, big healthcare data. Let's start a little bit with a background. As Pedro already explained, I have a background as a computer scientist, which basically means, of course, I have to come up as a researcher with novel results from a computer science point of view. And at the same time, of course, I try to pursue the boundary of medical research as well. And that's really sort of challenging combination to do both. So I try to come up with new results from a computer science point of view, and at the same time to have some sort of impact on medicine. It also explains a little bit the sort of focus I have on the medical research. Because in the end, if you're a medical doctor, you know that there's a lot known about the biological content behind medicine. And in some sense, medical knowledge is really shallow. It's rather rich, complicated, and in many problems, clinicians try to use this sort of knowledge in order to solve their problems. And I think, therefore, you also need some sort of rich formalism in order to represent that knowledge, in order to come up with sort of decent knowledge representation methods. Quite a lot of research has been done in this area, and we do that sort of research ourselves as well. And quite a lot of progress has been made, but I think not really sufficient in the sense that if you look at what medical people are doing at the moment, you really see methods which in some sense are rather shallow in my opinion. You look at the results and in some sense they are able to solve problems, but somehow the richness what you normally see in a medical textbook is missing from those methods. And that's more or less what I try to achieve, to bridge that boundary between what is available in computer science and the sort of rich content which is always behind the medical problems you try to solve. So that explains the emphasis on knowledge representation. Of course, another issue is uncertainty. In medicine also, uncertainty is an essential ingredient. Without any uncertainty, you cannot really do sort of decent clinical decision making. And that means that somehow, if you try to do machine learning in that particular context, we try to use knowledge representation together with uncertainty. And of course, you compare this to standard medical statistics, which is pretty able to solve many, sometimes very complicated problems very well. They're certainly able to deal with uncertainty, but I think they're quite lacking with respect to knowledge representation. So that also explains what I try to focus on today. I try to bridge, in fact, this boundary between uncertainty and knowledge representation in some way. Okay, let's move to the problem. In fact, that's just a sort of modern version of Pandora's box. So consider this particular patient. His name is Rob, 67 years old. Has been ill for a long while. And is actually treated for three different diseases: diabetes mellitus type 2. He has had a myocardial infarction. And he's also suffering from chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Sounds a little bit much, but actually, if you look at the statistics, it turns out to be the case that 2/3 of the patients of 65 years and older have very often two or more diseases at the same time. So it's rather the standard rather than something unique. And strange enough, if you look at medicine, you see that if you take out any sort of medical textbook, for instance, about internal medicine, we'll see there's a very strong focus on dealing with single disorders, which probably was the right way to deal with clinical problems, let's say, more than a century ago, when most people didn't become much older than 40 years old. But nowadays, people become older, and therefore they accumulate diseases, starting when they're about 55 years old, and then they just increasingly get more and more diseases, until very often there are three or four different diseases. And so, strange enough, this problem has only been recently recognized as a major problem of medicine. It's called the problem of multimorbidity. So, in fact, you have multiple illnesses at the same time. And of course, because you've got multiple illnesses, it could be the case that they somehow interact. And now, of course, you come across the problem that there's not really a lot of knowledge available about how those diseases interact to each other. With, of course, some exceptions, there are some clear cases where everybody knows that there must be some sort of interaction. So typical cases, if you look at cardiovascular diseases, so in that case, it's quite well known that there is some sort of interaction between heart diseases and, for instance, stroke, because it has the same origin. So that's something which is well known. But of course, there are many more diseases, and in many cases, people are simply lacking in knowledge in how to deal with this interaction. So that's really the topic of my talk. I want to focus on this specific problem. And so I just want to share some thoughts about how to deal with this. First thing you have to realize that rather than looking at single diseases, we are actually dealing with a rather complicated network of diseases, which appears to be extremely complicated. It's actually just a small part of the whole network. It's certainly not the complete network. And of course, given this highly complicated structure of diseases, you could try to organize it some way. So one particular way to organize those diseases, of course, in terms of classes of diseases, which are in this case indicated by different areas, just diseases which in some way are related to each other. But it doesn't really imply, of course, that there's no relationship between, let's say, disease somewhere here and disease somewhere over there. So there's a high complexity we are dealing with, because we are dealing with many, many thousands of individual diseases. And to make that situation even more complicated, we are also dealing with uncertain relationships between those diseases. And they're influenced by all sorts of factors, like regional factors, social factors. Clearly, gender takes a part in this as well. And so we are dealing with a rather complicated picture. And standard practice in medicine just to describe individual disease is certainly not adequate. So let's go back to the picture of machine learning then. So given this complicated network situation of diseases, somehow we have to come up with ways to represent that sort of knowledge. And I think that this idea of using network-like approaches could be a suitable starting point, because at least you start with the idea that somehow diseases interact with each other, and that clearly gives rise to the idea of using network-like approaches. We also have a lot of experience already with using probabilistic graphical models like Bayesian networks. So we already know that we, in principle, could use them for typical clinical problem-solving tasks like diagnosis or prediction, or decision theoretic planning for treatment, for instance. So they give a sort of right starting point for that sort of problems. In Nijmegen, of course, we also consider things related to the standard way many tasks are tackled in medicine, where people use clinical guidelines. So in principle, you could use that sort of probabilistic reasoning as part of a sort of automated clinical guideline. That's the sort of thing we're also working on. In this particular context, I think let's first start at the issue how to get that knowledge. So given the simple fact that quite a lot of knowledge about interaction between these is still missing, I think one of the challenges, of course, is to get at that knowledge. So that means that you start with a lot of healthcare data and try to learn how those diseases interact, and then see how far you get with it. So that's in fact also the way we started with it. So that brings us back to the problem of learning. As soon as you're able to learn that type of probabilistic models from your data, of course you would be able to do sort of decision supports, which currently is being offered by clinical guidelines. And you could offer some sort of diagnostic decision support to clinicians or even patients. Okay, let's go back to what we did. So in the Netherlands, the situation is first that a general practitioner had been working on collecting data of the patients for at least 25 years now. And here you see a couple of practices in the Netherlands, which are more or less meant as a sort of standard reference points for getting an impression of what the current health situation is in the Netherlands. So we have a special organization in the Netherlands called NIVEL, and they collect all that information coming from general practices. So those are the red dots and the blue dots of various sizes. So the bigger the dot, the higher the number of patients involved in it. And those data are extracted twice a year, and they are made available for analysis. And so we started with a very big database in order to understand interactions between particular diseases. It was, of course, one particular problem. We simply wanted to test our ideas, and it simply meant that we had to somehow that we needed some sort of point of reference, because if you discover new things, of course, you're not sure yet whether it is just a matter of noise or whether it's something which is real. So we initially focused our research to cardiovascular disease, because that's exactly the part of medicine where quite a lot is already known about interactions between diseases. So we use that particular area as a sort of point of reference. That's also the area where we focus on this particular talk. So we're dealing with a lot of data, and those data come from different practices. So there's something we have to take into account. Of course, we're dealing with different areas. So there's variance in urbanicity, in sort of urbanicity in those different countries. Size of practices, type of practices, for instance, it could be sort of standard family practice, or it could be health center. So those practices vary from site to site. And we have to come up with special statistical methods in order to cope with this variance. So that's one of the things we have to deal with. And those techniques are actually called multi-level statistical techniques. There's also the sort of things I will focus on a little bit later. Let's first of all try to focus on the sort of way at the moment healthcare copes with this problem of multimorbidity. So we were, not, of course, not the first ones who discovered this problem. It was already discovered in the healthcare field. And you see a couple of sometimes rather simple techniques which are being used in the healthcare field in order to somehow capture this problem. So what you normally see, for instance, is that people have a sort of tendency to do a sort of paired comparison between different diseases. So basically, you try to understand whether there is an interaction between particular diseases. And then people use measures like likelihood ratio or odds ratio. Likelihood ratio, odds ratio, D1 and D2 are the two diseases. F could be any sort of finding, or it could also be empty, where you have to compare the two and try to get an impression whether those diseases could in principle interact. Of course, it does not imply that you really understand what the nature of the interaction is. The only thing they try to do is to understand whether there is an interaction or there's nothing. So for instance, if you look at this particular table, you'll see that this odds ratio is bigger than one. And so there is an interaction between diabetes mellitus and stroke and, for instance, hypertension. So here there's actually quite a lot of interaction. So except, of course, that it doesn't give you any sort of understanding of the nature of the interaction between those diseases. Of course, you already know that in many cases we're dealing with more than two diseases at the same time. And so you could not really look at a paired comparison. You have to look at a more complicated picture. And that also explains why other techniques are being used. Notably, there's quite a lot of papers where people are using regression techniques. So it depends on the sort of thing they try to explain. So for instance, it could be the case that we are dealing with a continuous outcome indicated by O. And we're dealing with a couple of explanatory variables. So in our case, it could be individual diseases. And somehow we try to understand how those individual diseases interact in order to cause a particular outcome. So of course, that's something you could model in this particular way, just by logistic regression equation. And in some cases, in other papers, people try to understand the interaction between a disease and other disease. In that case, we're dealing with a dichotomous outcome. So disease is present or absent. And again, you try to model this by slightly different logistic regression, where you take the logit of the probability in that case. And basically try to model the interaction between a couple of diseases. Just as an example, for instance, let's assume that we try to model the interaction between two diseases, D1 and D2. So we have separate terms and we have an interaction term. This does give rise to a particular effect. So basically what you try to model is the interaction between the present and absent disease and the present and absent of particular findings indicated by F. So that's what I just wrote down in this slide just by using rather simple probability theory. Okay, so basically the conclusion therefore is that people somehow already realized that in order to understand this problem of multimorbidity, you have to somehow model the interaction between diseases. And it would not be sufficient to only look at pairs. Things are a little bit more complicated than that. And so you see also other proposals in the literature. So for instance, if you would be interested in the interaction between disease D2 and D1, for instance, we have the situation that you assume that D1 is the uncertain case, and D2 becomes a predictor together with particular findings. But of course, it could also be the other way around. So you could have the situation that you take D1 as a predictor, and in addition, you have the findings, and then you try to predict the presence of disease D2. And you even find where people try to model the interaction between diseases. So you could come up with things like this. So you already get a sort of feeling that in principle this could work, but things become quite easily rather complicated because you're dealing with many, many interaction terms. You come up with quite a number of different equations. And in the end, of course, that wouldn't really work. So basically, you get a progression model for every individual outcome variable. So for instance, let's look at a case where you have five different diseases, you would end up with five different regression equations. And also you have to take into account all the possible interactions. So that doesn't make your model rather easy. You come up with an whole family of different models, which basically try to model a different aspect of the whole problem. So what's the, from a sort of graphical point of view, the main criticism of this particular approach? So what you could do for a regression equation is to come up with a sort of graphical version of it. So in this particular case, we're dealing with a regression equation concerning the response variable D1. So this, in this particular case, just a disease. We have two findings, two symptoms, for instance. We have two other diseases, D2 and D3. And basically, what you try to model is a function of D1 of all the other variables, including their interaction. And you also assume that D1 is uncertain and all the predictors are certain. Despite the fact, of course, that if you look at the data, of course, there's no reason why D2 is more certain than D1. So it's a sort of diagnostic model. There's a particular direction. The only thing you can do with a model like this is to draw a conclusion about D1. What I think is a better way to model this problem is just to look at the actual interaction between the different diseases and the different findings. So a model which has this rather strong causal interpretation. So for instance, it could be the case that D1 causes disease D2, D2 in turn causes disease D3. And here you have the associated findings, but F1, for instance, only related to D1, and F2 is only related to D2. So that, I think, gives you a much clearer picture of how the diseases interact, and also gives you an explanation of the interaction between findings and the diseases. So that basically means that just, in this case, a Bayesian network, which I tried to model, and that's something I could try to learn from the data that is available by means of structured learning. So I think it has a couple of advantages. Let's try to understand this advantage in terms of this problem of multimorbidity again. So there are, in the literature, different types of multimorbidity distinguished. One particular type, which is often described called concurrent multimorbidity, basically it simply means that two independent diseases occur at the same time. And then, of course, the question is whether they are really independent or not. So in terms of probability theory, it simply means that two diseases, DI and DJ, are dependent. You can simply multiply the prevalences to each other. But then, of course, it makes you wonder whether they're also conditionally independent. So that it means that if you take all the possible findings which are related to the diseases, it is really the case that the product, so the joint probability of the diseases given the findings, is really equal to the individual product. You also see this in the logistic regression equation which you try to use. For instance, you see that there's no interaction term, so there's no interaction. But if you simply try to learn the structure from the data, you simply see that there is no connection between, in this case, diseases, depression, hypertension, and also no link to any symptom, for instance, in this case indicated by the abstract symptom. So they're simply not connected to each other at all. But that's not always the case. So there's another case of concurrent multimorbidity. So again, the diseases are independent, which is clearly indicated by looking at correlation between the two. So they're not correlated. But in this particular case, if we condition on a particular finding, you're able to see that they are dependent. So it's not really the case that you can simply say that the joint probability of the two diseases is equal to their individual product. Again, it's also reflecting the logistic regression equation. In this case, there is an interaction term. But if you look at the structure, it becomes much clearer, because what you have to see is that for those particular diseases, COPD in this case, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and hypertension, there's a common effect, heart failure. So if you look at the resulting graph, it really tells you is what the nature of the interaction is. Of course, there are other cases as well. A quite common complication is confounding. So in that particular case, we're dealing with a common cause. So you look at the interaction between disease and effect. It turns out to be the case that the diseases are correlated to each other. So of course, the next question, of course, is of course, what's the reason behind this? If you look at the logistic regression equation, effect, it gives you exactly the same result as in my first case of concurrent multimorbidity. So there's no interaction according to this equation. But if you now try to learn the structure from the data, you actually get a structure like this, telling you that in fact there is a common cause for both diseases, COPD and lung cancer, for instance, is caused by smoking. So that's in this case a clear explanation for the fact that there is an interaction between COPD and lung cancer. that was a sort of common cause which mediates this interaction. And the final case is that we are also dealing with dependent diseases, so there is an interaction between DI and DJ. But in this particular case, the interaction is just a direct interaction between disease DI and DJ, which again is reflected into your probabilistic dependence structure, which looks like this in terms of standard probability theory. The logistic regression ends tells you there is an interaction, but if you look at structural learning, you get something like this, which is in fact different from the other situation. So it tells you there's a direct interaction between the disease COPD and pulmonary hypertension, for instance. And there is a sort of cause which causes only one of those two. So that's sort of summary. It's your sort of motivation that if you try to use graphical models, you get something extra. It's not completely the case that you get something which is 100% new. Because if you look at the logistic regression equation, you also get similar sort of information. It simply gives you some extra detail and sort of details which are certainly very relevant from a clinical point of view. So we are dealing with multimorbidity. We have concurrent, and it could be the case that there are associations between diseases. And then we can make a distinction between conditional independence and, in fact, the opposite, conditional dependence. So here, there's no connection at all between the disease. In this case, there is a connection, but that's because there's a common effect. In this particular case, there is a correlation between the diseases, but in fact, the correlation in this case is spurial. So there is a common cause causing both the diseases. And this second case, there is also a correlation, but there's, because there's a direct effect. And all those sorts of information can be recovered by means of structural learning of Bayesian networks. Whereas if you compare it to the situation you normally get if you use logistic regression, well, it tells you something, but not as much details as you get over here. Okay, so that's sort of motivation of why it might be useful to consider using Bayesian network and structural learning in this particular context, and also explains why we started using Bayesian networks for trying to understand this problem of multimorbidity. Just to summarize, so the sort of standard approach, which is logistic regression, well, you get one model for every outcome variable, but very often you need to incorporate the outcome variable in another model and therefore get multiple models. And you have this problem that there are multiple interpretations for different outcomes of your regression coefficients. Compared to something like a Bayesian network, well, you get just one model. So the model tells you everything. And it also gives you some extra information about the underlying process, which you can look at, and you can further look into this. You get sort of automatic interaction understanding of the different diseases. And of course, it does allow you to distinguish different forms of multimorbidity. Okay, let's go back then a little bit further. Let's go a little bit further and look at what you can actually do with Bayesian networks. So there's already quite a lot of experience in modeling clinical problems using Bayesian networks. And despite the fact that nowadays you can actually learn Bayesian networks from data, so without any sort of background knowledge, what is actually quite powerful about Bayesian networks is that there are certain principles which you can always adopt, and you can always start a sort of initial model and actually guide the learning process in such a way that you get something which is really meaningful. So if you try to model an individual disease, so this is the actual disease, you always have the situation that the general characteristics like environment, genetics, specific patient characteristic like gender, age, they always give you variables which go into the disease variable. It's always the case. So that's of course something you can actually use in order to guide the learning process. Then an outcoming variable is always pathophysiology, with including signs and symptoms, always going outside of the disease variable. And the same is the case for laboratory results. So you always get exactly the same structure. And so even without any sort of data, you already have a sort of general feeling how your model is going to look like. And of course, if you've got data, it even gets better. You get a model which is able to fit to the data pretty well. Of course, you could do exactly the same when you're dealing with multiple diseases. Of course, your model becomes much more complicated. I cannot deny that, but still, you have this very strong principle that you still have that the environment characteristic and generally go into the individual diseases. Here you have the pathophysiology, here the signs and symptoms, etc. So you get sort of repetition of this general idea. Now, in our particular case, of course, we were dealing with a technical problem, which was the simple fact that if you're dealing with the interactions between different diseases, you need special data for that. You cannot simply use highly specialized clinical data for one particular disease. You have to deal with big data sets which cover a lot of different diseases. So that also brings me back to this problem, which is rather standard in this area of multimorbidity research, is that people somehow try to cope with the characteristics of, for instance, different practices and different populations in a particular country. So somehow you have to deal with that particular problem. And in statistics, people try to use special multi-level techniques in order to model those particular characteristics of your data. So that's something we had to deal with in the conservation networks as well. So in just to summarize what's normally done in this particular area. So the technique of multi-level regression simply means we have again the idea of using a linear equation in order to model the interaction between different terms, but we get something extra in complexity. So we get a so-called level variable which are added to it in order to model the variation within particular groups and between the different groups. For the rest, the idea is more or less the same as with standard logistic regression. Just ignore any equation, let's look at the results. So if you just lump all the data together, let's assume that we, in this case, try to model this by means of standard linear regression. And these are the data points we got. You would expect a line which goes just through all the points, and which allows us to model the lumped data set. In the case of multi-level regression, what we actually get, we distinguish different groups, group A and B, indicated by red and blue. And you actually see that we get different lines. So basically what we try to model is, are the characteristics of those different groups. and we get in this case two different regression equations, which model those differences. So in principle, of course, that would work, but again, of course, we have those disadvantages which we already encountered when we looked at Bayesian networks. So we are dealing with equations, so we get the problem that we have only one outcome variable, and we try to model a function of predictors in terms of one outcome. The predictions are treated as uncertain. That's not the case for the predictors. We don't have any explicit knowledge about the predictors. So that's the sort of thing we want to solve. And in principle, of course, is something we could try to handle by means of Bayesian networks. Again, we get this idea, try to deal with all the interaction between diseases and the different things we try to model, which in principle would give rise to equations which would probably look like this. You see many different equations, and somehow you lose the problem you're going to solve just by in terms of the complexity of your models. A little bit about Bayesian networks, just to give you a little bit of background, just in one slide. So Bayesian network is nothing else than just sort of graphical formalism which allows you to model a joint probability distribution, in this case just in terms of n variables. And the idea simply tells you if we got a joint probability distribution, we're able to compute any probability. So for instance, there's just standard probability theory. We've got this joint, for instance, we could always compute the probability of only the variable x1 taking the value x1, or for instance x2 equal to taking the value xn, and any subset of that, and also conditioned on any other variable. So in principle, given the specification of a Bayesian network, we're able to compute any probability. So that's a principle behind Bayesian network. Another thing is that you can quite easily model a Bayesian network in terms of a graph. So in this case, we try to model graph in terms of two diseases, HT, hypertension, and diabetes mellitus. And we only consider gender to be an important factor in those. And we have one outcome variable, in this case, heart failure. And it is a model in that sense that all the variables are in principle uncertain. So you could in principle compute the probability of a particular gender, for instance, given that somebody has heart failure or not heart failure. So it is a very flexible sort of model which allows you to compute any probability, because in principle, despite the fact that the arrows indicate direction, you could actually compute any probability of any subset of variables conditioned on any other set of variables. And as I already said, we can in principle learn the structure and the parameters from the data, taking into account the principles in designing a Bayesian network. So we're dealing with this problem that we are dealing with a very big data set. For instance, where data have been collected for different general practices. So that's called hierarchical data. And somehow we have to deal with this fact that the data is hierarchical. So multi-level regression is a standard technique to do this. And at the moment, that sort of in the Netherlands, Utrecht, Gelderland, and Limburg. There are actually quite a number of other provinces as well. And this is the sort of population you find in those practices. So it could be city population or rural. So that gives you the opportunity to instantiate your network for a particular type of population. And here we have the standard condition variable like gender. So the idea is that we use those variables as deterministic variables, so they only get probability 0 and 1. And they give you the opportunity to change your probability distribution over here. So that's the basic idea. So we use that technique for the problem of cardiovascular diseases. Just a sort of illustration that it worked. So we started with this big data set from the Dutch population of patients, which in this case concerned patients which went to the general practitioner. And we tried to understand whether there's a certain dynamic behind different diseases. So that explains why we collected data for three different time periods. So there was a baseline time period. We looked at the follow-up 3 years late, and we also looked at the follow-up 5 years later. And the idea is that we try to understand whether diseases are changing. So the first thing, of course, was trying to learn the structure from the data of the network from the data. So here you find our multi-level variable practice. And here we obtained a similar sort of structure through different time points. So let's look what you could do with a network of this. So as I said, in principle, you got a Bayesian network, you can actually compute any probability because you have a fully specified probability distribution. So for instance, what we could compute was the dynamics of different diseases. So here you find, for instance, sort of diagrams which we used in order to illustrate that the number of diseases indeed change in time. So for instance, of patients with zero complaints, it turned out to be the case that 86% 3 years later, again, zero complaints, but 12% had one complaint and 2% had two complaints. Where also patients which had only one risk factor, 86% had still one risk factor 3 years later, 11% had two risk factors, 3% of three risk factors, etc. So what you see is that if you look at the dynamic, the number of risk factors in general only increase. So it's never the case that the number of risk factors actually decrease. You only see an increase. And same was true for the number of chronic diseases. So for instance, the baseline, so it's time zero, 91% of the patients still had zero diseases 3 years later, 8% had one disease extra, and 1% had two diseases extra. Of patients with one disease, 80% still had one disease 3 years later, 70% had two diseases, etc. So all that information is available in this particular model. You can just fill in variables in this model and just compute that sort of information. What you could also do is to focus on specific diseases. So for instance, if you look at the model, you see that we have a variable diabetes mellitus. What you simply can do is just fill in that a particular patient has diabetes mellitus. So you get a sort of specialized or personalized model. And then you could look what sort of effect it has on all the other variables. So that's what I show on this particular plot. In this case, we looked at different diseases. So ischemic heart disease, heart failure, stroke, nephropathy. And basically we try to understand whether there's a difference between diabetics and non-diabetic patients. And what you see is that the diabetic patient in some cases, like for ischemic heart disease, have a much higher prevalence. And they, so in terms of age, you see that you get a very high percentage of patients who actually do have ischemic heart disease at a certain age. It compares to the non-diabetics. Whereas in this case, the difference is less strong. Okay, so that brings me to a summary of my talk. So basically what I try to illustrate by, in this case, by this example, multimorbidity, is that I think that if you want to do machine learning in medicine, you need a sort of combination of different techniques. So I think it does make sense to also consider this problem of how to represent medical knowledge, not in terms of simply equations, but in models which are richer, gives you much more flexibility and also allow you to extract much more information. Also try to illustrate that if you look at different types of data, in our case, we are dealing with big healthcare data, just big data sets in this case across the whole Netherlands. Sometimes you have to come up with a new idea, new techniques in order to get the technique working. So that explains this idea of multi-level Bayesian networks. So I think if you look at this model, well, they, of course, they look very complicated, but they're certainly rich models. And what I try to illustrate by means of the diagrams, you can extract quite a lot of useful information from those models without carrying out extra experiments or so. You start with your model and they give you already quite a lot of information. And also information which is also relevant from a clinical point of view, I think. Okay, so far my talk. So what we try to do in the end, of course, is to see whether we can use that sort of information in designing clinical guidelines. So as a research unit, we're also involved in research having to deal with the design of clinical guidelines. And that sort of information, of course, could be used in order to design, for instance, guidelines for multimorbidity. So that's the sort of things we're also involved in. Okay, thank you.
So thank you, Peter. We have time for some questions, please. Yes, please.
Thank you so much for your interesting talk. It's a very interesting issue at the point. I understand that you are searching for relations between different diseases, but I was not sure if you were also looking into the environment impact on those patients, because you showed a map, and I think that there is information related to the environment that may be useful, perhaps for public policies. Are you looking into that?
Well, but, yeah. So one of the problems, of course, is that data collection is something which is just started. So if you look at sort of healthcare data we currently using, there's only about 7 years ago that general practitioners also collected laboratory data. So what you see currently happening is that people are collecting more and more data. And that would also allow you to look at more complicated factors and also risk factors. Yes. So I think that's something which will actually happen in the future.
Yes. Another question that I like to ask is, were you looking into family relations between diseases? If the patient had a father died with a a stroke. Were you looking into increased risks for those, looking into the genetics of the disease?
No, again, that sort of information was missing in the data we used. Mm-hmm. But you're right, of course, it is the sort of information you would like to use. Mm-hmm. So in general practice, you see that currently the data which is being collected is becoming much and much more detailed. So that would allow you to answer that sort of questions in the future.
Okay, thank you. More questions? I have one. Do you think this multimorbidity problem actually requires, as you said, that data is gathered for multiple problems, multiple diseases in a much, I would say, higher level degree of specificity, because you cannot have all the very relevant variables that if you're studying only a single disease, you would have. What kind of challenges does this pose to data management in the healthcare institutions? If you could, for example, elaborate a little bit how it is being done in the Netherlands, so that we could see if it is somehow related to what we have in Portugal.
I think data collection is sort of byproduct of clinical practice. So I think that's clearly one of the disadvantages. And that's also the way it started in the Netherlands with the general practices. So they started data collection, I think, a little bit more than 20 years ago. A little bit strange. You would not expect that the general practice was much more advanced than a university hospital. But that was exactly the case. So they were collecting data and using computers already decades before hospitals were considering that. And I think the next step for them was to come up with the idea that you can actually use that data for research, because that, of course, could be, maybe even should be, the next step. And that was also something they started to work on. Whereas I think in a clinical environment, it would be pretty hard. What you normally see is that clinicians who do research focus on one specific disease and would collect data from one particular project and then probably stop afterwards. So that would not really give you a good basis for research at all. So I think it's quite a lot can be learned from what the general practitioners did in the Netherlands in that sense.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. I'm particularly interested in continuous signals and doing signal processing for continuous signals for healthcare, such as ECG, PCG. So is it simple to integrate into this mathematical framework, or should we have to first analyze it, divide it into categories, and then include it in a Bayesian network? Or can we use the same mathematics and actually have these continuous variables so we can infer all this information?
Well, so Bayesian networks are not limited to discrete variables at all. So you could quite easily cope with continuous variables. So that's not really the problem. But of course, from a computational point of view, it could be pretty hard to interpret signals. But that's something which can be done with different techniques. So for instance, if you are dealing with time series, you could do something which is called continuous time Bayesian networks. So then time is made continuous, and you can actually model time in this particular way, and even represent that sort of signals. So the answer is you could in principle do this, although you may need special techniques for that.
It's very interesting because I work with Anna, and one of the projects we're actually configuring right now is a project where we'll hopefully have this, you know, an electronic health record with environmental variables, temperature, humidity, etc., the family history, and sensed continuous signals. So suddenly this looks like a really interesting approach.
Yeah, so I've actually a PhD student who's currently trying to merge those two approaches. So continuous time, basically try to merge it with discrete time. Because in medicine, you very often have those two different types of signals.
Very exciting.
Yeah, maybe the last point I want to stress is this strange thing that multimorbidity. So that's a big problem, and somehow medicine has ignored this. And as far as I know, nobody's willing to solve this. So it makes me wonder what will actually happen in the future, because given the fact that 2/3 of the patients have more than two or more diseases, that number will actually increase in the future. So that's rather strange. So and medicine, which is nowadays a highly specialized area, simply means that people in any university hospital only focus on single diseases, never on multimorbidity. So the university hospitals are not going to solve this.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Thank you. No more questions. Thank you again for your excellent presentation. And thank you all for being here now. So I just want to thank Peter again. And hopefully.
Thank you.
Hopefully, some of you will deal with multimorbidity in the future. Okay?